When I paid attention to the case of Herculaneum as part of my PhD thesis on religious practices of traders and craftsmen in Roman Italy, I was struck by the few visible signs of worship in the workplaces of the municipality. This was in stark contrast to the image of shops and workshops in the Via della Bonanza in Pompeii, or to a passage from a letter from Fronto to Marcus Aurelius in which he relates that all the money changers' tables, all the shops, all the taverns, etc., had figurative representations of members of the imperial family. An in-depth study of religious evidence in private context in the Civitas Herculaneensis revealed a more nuanced reality. On the one hand, this variety concerned the location or even the existence of religious facilities within the workspaces. On the other hand, a certain diversity is reflected not only in the rites performed, but also in the deities honored by tradespeople. I have tried to understand what such variety reveals in terms of societal settings. In other words, what do religious practices of craftspeople and traders reflect on their integration into different social groups? Do they reflect representations that tradespeople had of themselves and of their activities? Even more concretely, do the sacra privata of craftsmen and merchants provide information on their daily work? In other words, do their private rites provide information on their material relationship to work? Here, I will only deal with the religious evidence that is attested within the very workspaces. One of the first observations we can make is this one. In Herculaneum, the fact that shop or workshop had a sacrarium, that is to say a shrine, seems to go hand in hand with the fact that it was an inhabited workplace. This is the case of this bakery, located southwest of the Temple of Cybele. In addition to the spaces that were properly productive, notably the milling and baking room, the establishment had residential rooms, one of which, south of the entrance from the Cardo 5, was fitted with a sido edicola. As you can see, a sido edicola is a niche built into a wall in such a way as to look like a small temple, here with pediment and columns on the facade. A craftsman working semi-precious stones also lived in his workshop, since a small bedroom was set up between the two workspaces, one in the back room and the other open to the street and fitted with a sacrarium that included a statuette of Bacchus and a perfume burner. A small portable altar was also used to make offerings in the back room. The shop in 615 was a simple room with a sacred space, but the presence of a floor accessible by a staircase set up against the eastern wall seems to indicate that, here again, the workplace was inhabited. We could multiply the examples and draw parallels with other attested cases in the nearby Pompeian colony, but let us stop there and note that in Pompeii, like in Herculaneum, the deities worshipped must have protected the whole household, of which the workspace was an integral part, in the same way that work was an integral part of the life of these individuals. In other words, for the craftsmen and traders of the Vesuvian cities, the place of work was regularly the place of life, an assimilation that reveals the centrality of work in the daily lives of these modest populations. Where did they locate their sacred spaces and which deities did they honor? We're going to see that the choices made do not seem unrelated to the work status of tradespeople, particularly in terms of identity and community relationship. First of all, let us note that the sacred spaces in workplaces are very often not far from the instrumentum. The instrumentum is the equipment of a workplace, an equipment which, in legal texts in particular, defines the structures of trade and production, and which, in the collective imagination, refers by metonymy to economic activity as a whole. In Herculaneum, the proximity between sacrarium and instrumentum, that is to say, between shrine and equipment, is particularly striking in food shops, where the religious evidence often appears either above the sales counter or just facing it. Ultimately, this was an explicit way of placing commercial activity under divine supervision. In this type of shop, we might wonder whether it is not also, or even more so, the visibility of the Sacrarium from the street that was sought after. The trader's pietas thus serve as a token of honesty for the mercantile exchange. These two reasons are, of course, not exclusive of each other. The relationship with the customers and the will to protect the trade also stand out in the choice of the deities honoured by the craftsmen and traders of Herculaneum. It is true that few representations of deities from the municipality's workplaces have come down to us, but it should be noted that Bacchus is present on several occasions in food shops where, as you know, wine was generally served and stored. The predominance of Bacchus in the recorded evidence seems to indicate the popularity of this god in the municipality, not surprising in a region that, in Roman times, was famous for its wine-growing lands. Thus, the god of wine was probably also invoked in Herculaneum as a great local deity. The tradespeople of the municipality fully exploited the polytheistic regime to ensure the protection of their professional activities. The sacrarium of this food shop was intended for Bacchus, enthroned in a central position, but also for Mercury and probably Hercules. The presence of the god of gain and trade is hardly surprising in this kind of establishment. As for Hercules, his presence is explained by the history of the city of Herculaneum, which, according to local mythology, was founded by this deity. The snakes that framed the pseudo-edicule were the zoomorphic manifestation of the genus loci, that is to say, the protective force on human of the place whose territory they marked. Likewise, an inn-width restaurant was placed under the triple protection of a genus loci, Mercury, and Priapus, god of fertility, also progressively associated with gain and abundance. Once again, these paintings were in close proximity to the equipment of the establishment and visible from the street, aware of ensuring the honesty of the commercial transactions that took place there. This last aspect is particularly obvious in the sign of a wine shop depicting Semosynchus performing a libation. Semosynchus is the Deus Fidius traditionally invoked in the protection of oaths. The cult data that are recorded at Herculaneum resonate with those of the neighbouring Pompeian colony or with literary and epigraphic texts. The plurality of cults that were rendered within workplaces was linked to the social fragmentation of Roman society, in other words, to the integration of each individual into multiple community networks. The piety of craftsmen and merchants was certainly conditioned by their professional identity with the possible technical, social, or even moral qualities of each one, but it did not leave out many other aspects of their identities, such as their belonging to a city or a region. It was therefore the set of social relations structuring the life of tradespeople that conditioned their sacra privata, their private rights. Finally, it should be noted that the Laris and the genius paterfamiliaris are totally absent from the shops and the workshops of the Civitas Herculanensis. This sharply contrasts with the neighbouring Pompeian colony, where, on the contrary, these deities predominate. Is this disparity due solely to the data that have come down to us? Perhaps. But perhaps this difference can also be explained by distinct socio-economic configurations in the two cities. In Pompeii, it is mainly integration into a familia and clientelistic dependence that emerge through the honored deities. This could reflect a family economic management, centered and controlled by each paterfamilias. Was the social and economic fabric of the Herculaneum municipality organized differently? Specifically, did family groups have less weight in daily working relationships than in Pompeii? In Herculaneum, other factors seem to have played a determining role in the cults, in particular the insertion in the history of the town and in local life, especially in the local economic life. We know from the preserved fragments from the municipality album that in the last years of the city, Herculaneum had an important community mixed and counted many in Colei. These citizens, coming from different cities of Italy, had come to settle in the city for commercial reasons. Wasn't displaying the new local roots through religious practices an effective way to ensure their integration in the host city? Eventually, even though it is advisable to remain cautious in view of the available data, religious evidence seems to contribute to a set of clues that allows us to glimpse human relations that are difficult to perceive otherwise. Studying religious practices of tradespeople is therefore a way of gaining a better understanding of this category of the population, which has left relatively few written traces. The case of Herculaneum clearly showed the need to cross-reference the data from the site as much as possible with those recorded elsewhere, especially in Pompeii, bearing in mind, of course, the social, economic, historical, etc. disparities between these towns. It is the repetition of similar observations in similar configurations that may support the hypothesis put forward here. Thank you for listening.